The 2022 season has come to an end as we saw the Los Angeles Angels have won the 2022 World Series 4-1 over our San Francisco Giants. The World Series MVP was Carlos Santana. He hit the walk-off home run to win it in Game 5. He also had a couple big hits in other games as well, including a grand slam, and I forget which game exactly it was. The AL entire postseason MVP was Justin Upton, while the NL postseason MVP was Tetsuro Yamada. I personally didn't think he had as good of a postseason as Stuart Fairchild, but I guess that's just me. Tetsuro Yamada wins the award. So now we have arrived at the offseason to prepare for the 2023, which will be season 5 of this franchise. And since we have already gone over the stats and the league leaders and the award winners from the regular season in the regular season plus playoff preview, which there should be a little card on the screen right now that you can click on if you would like to watch that, and also it'll probably be linked in the outro screen. So because we've already gone over those, we are going to hop straight into the retirement section of the offseason, where there actually weren't any big-name retirements this year. There was really only two worth mentioning, the first one being Josh Donaldson, who retired after playing exactly one game while being on the Angels roster for all 162 of them, because that makes a lot of sense. So Josh Donaldson, his career has come to an end. And then the other one worth mentioning was Joe Smith, who was still an effective pitcher very late into his career, but he suffered a head fracture, assuming he took a line drive to the skull, and that's never good. So Joe Smith has called it quits. He is now gonna be hanging up the cleats. And it's also worth mentioning that nobody made the Hall of Fame. And before we actually hop into the re-signs and free agency, we do have some staff to sign, because our manager, our hitting coach, our pitching coach, and our first base coach all had their coach contracts expire. Yes, you heard that correctly. Bruce Bochy did not retire still. It was just his contract ran up, so we're not going to be bringing him back, because I was hoping he was going to retire after year one like he does in real life, and I don't want him to be my manager anymore, so Bruce Bochy will not be back. We will be having a new manager, and also our farm director retired. So first thing we did was we bring back our hitting coach and pitching coaches, because I thought they were good, and our hitting and pitching was very good this season. Landon Baldwin being the hitting coach and Rudy Lieber being the pitching coach. We also hired our new manager. He is a fake guy named Barry Gage. Our new first base coach is Harry Hayek. And then our new farm director is Paul Regan. And now that this staff hiring is out of the way, we are going to jump into the re-signs, which, as always, I am not going to go through and show literally every single player in the organization that we re-signed. That would just take forever. I'm going to show the main ones, the ones I want to talk about, plus the ones that were questionable if I was going to bring them back or not, as well as show the ones we opted to not re-sign and let walk into free agency. So the biggest re-signing that we had, of course, was Jock Peterson. He is back. I said in the regular season recap plus playoff preview video that the plan was to bring him back, and he's back. 3 more years of Jock Peterson. He is such a big part of our team. He is a vital part to our lineup. He's pretty much the face of my Giants, I would say. I would say he's probably, like, he's the Giants when it comes to my Giants. He's probably who people think of when they think of my Giants. Obviously, you guys can comment on that. If you agree, let me know in the comments. But with that being said, Jock Peterson is back for 3 more seasons to be the left fielder against right-handed pitching. We also tried to bring back Lorenzo Ordóñez on a 4-year deal at $3 million per, but he never actually signed it for whatever reason. I guess he didn't want to commit to that long of a contract, so we ended up just having to renew his contract for $800,000, so he'll be back for yet another season. I was hoping to try to lock out all his arbitration years at a decent price, but could not do that this offseason, unfortunately. We also brought back Chase Numata. I wasn't 100% sure if I wanted him back, but I figured he's a pretty decent backup catcher. He's got great fielding, pretty decent hitting stats, and he's got a ton of team control, so I thought that was pretty solid to have. So he's back on a 1-year, $700,000 deal. While Tommy Canley was brought back for another year as well, he will more than likely, I would say it's definite that he's going to be in AAA to start the year. It's always good to have bullpen depth, and Tommy Canley is definitely bullpen depth, as well as Brandon Finnegan is bullpen depth. He was brought back through arbitration. The panel sided with us for $1.6 million on his salary this season. I'm hoping he does not have an absurd walk per nine this year, but Brendan Finnegan is back in our AAA team. As far as players we did not bring back, the biggest one was probably Justin Turner. I changed his position to first base to hope that he could sign with somebody in the offseason, because he's definitely a first baseman at this point in his career. Obviously, he had a very good year for us, but he is getting up there in years, and I did not want to bring him back, so Justin Turner is not going to be on the team next year. There was also Hyunjin Ryu, who I fully did not plan on bringing back the whole year. I just wanted 1 year of him, so he's going to be heading into free agency as well. Devin Travis will also join those two, the guy we picked up at the deadline from the Blue Jays. Shane Peterson, our first baseman from 2021, who had a breakout season that year, and then didn't really do anything in 2022, and then he ended up going to AAA and hurting himself. So Shane Peterson, he is, I believe, 35 years old now. He will not be back. Matt Wieters was our backup catcher this year. He will also not be back. And then some other guys who are less notable are Trevor Gott will not be brought back. Teron Guerrero, the fireballer we picked up at the waiver wire at the start of the 2022 season. And then Carson Fulmer, we are finally giving up on him. He just has no role in our organization. He's never going to get a shot with us. So Carson Fulmer is going to probably be picked up by another team, but you never really know how free agency works in this game. There's pretty much always really good players just sitting in free agency. So now we move on to the free agency portion of the episode, and there are a lot of great free agents in this year's class. There are guys like Andrew Benintendi, Aaron Judge, Jameson Taillon, Jose Berrios, Jose Ramirez, Wilson Contreras, Gary Sanchez, Chad Green. There's a ton of names. Kevin Kiermaier's there. There is going to be a huge redistribution of talent throughout the league this year because a lot of these guys are very key players on their team. A lot of the Yankees' talent was not brought back. Hopefully those guys are brought back in real life, because if we lose Gary and Judge to free agency in real life, I am going to be not very happy with that if that's what happens in real life, but that's what happens in this game. And our plan heading into free agency this year was, I didn't really plan on doing much. I feel like our team is still very good enough to make another deep playoff run, and we still have quite a few players who are set to be free agents next year, so I felt like I didn't want to go all out and sign anybody long term this year, since we're going to be opening up a ton of a ton of our salary is going to be coming off the books next season. And then also we have a bunch of young guys who will continue to improve and get better as the seasons go on. But since I saw how many great players were available, we did sign a few of them, three to be exact, only one of them long term though, and that one long term contract that we signed was Joey Gallo. He was the first signing we made. We offered him like right away. I simmed one day and he was like, hey, I'm signing with you. So Joey Gallo, 5 years of him at $17.8 million per. He will be 33 in that final year of his contract, so he should not be digressing or getting worse as the contract goes on. He should still be very, very good throughout the contract. He is 29 years old currently. Incredible power, we know that. He walks a ton, we know that. And he was also great defensively. He had a down year in 2022, only a 7.11 OPS, which is not ideal at all. I am confident that was a fluke, though, because he was very good in the other years of this franchise. And also, his ratings are just too good for him to consistently put up a 7.11 OPS. So the plan is for him to play third base this year, because he can play third base. He has an incredible arm. He's very good defensively. He even plays center field in real life. And that could be somewhere he ends up for us. He could shift to center field or right field once Fuentes is ready to play third base, if that ends up happening. For now, Fuentes is going to play first and Gallo is going to play third. I'm fine if Gallo plays third all 5 years of his contract with us, but the plan for at least to start is for him to be at third, and he could possibly shift to the outfield in the future. We also went out and picked up a bullpen piece on a one-year deal, Ryan Presley. Our bullpen just got even stronger. Hopefully it's going to help us make another deep playoff run. Our bullpen was already pretty insane, and Ryan Presley just makes it even more insane. And then the third signing we went out and got was Manny Margot, who is going to be our new center fielder. We signed him to a two-year $18.5 million per He is actually the second year on that contract is actually a player option, so he has the option to either come back next year or not come back. How I look at this signing is basically, it's improving on center field. Aaron Altherr has obviously been good for us, but Manny Margot in this franchise has been insane. He had a breakout 2022 season. He sort of broke out in 2021, but not as much as 2022. This franchise started off 2019, he had a sub 600 OPS. 2020, he had a sub 700 OPS. And then in 2021, he just randomly put up an 844 OPS. He was like, all right, I finally figured out a hit. And then he showed up in 2022 and was like, all right, I'm starting against righties and lefties this year, and I'm going to put up my career high in home runs, which is 29. And that's a pretty significant jump, because his career high before that was 13 in 2017. So he got a pretty significant ratings boost. Most notably, his right-handed pitching contact went up 11 points, and his power versus lefties went up 12 points just from last season. So Manny Margot is a very solid hitter, extremely good defensively, and he has some great speed in center field. So he's an upgrade on Aaron Altherr, who is going to be a free agent at the end of this season anyway. So we either get basically an upgraded Altherr in center field, and if he decides to come back next year, cool. If not, that's cool too. The plan for the 2024 season is to retool anyway, since we have so many people who are going to be heading into free agency and are going to be wanting big contracts, so we're not going to be able to bring them back. So I'm totally fine if Margot does decide to not come back for that second year, but if he does, then he does, and I'm totally fine with that too. I thought that we might trade Aaron Altherr because of this signing, but I think we're just going to keep him and try him as the fourth outfielder instead. Stuart Fairchild will also be getting plenty of time in the big leagues. He'll be starting against left-handed pitchers in left field, of course, and he should be getting some decent time against righties as well. While Lorenzo Ordóñez is the odd man out here, he will start the year in AAA. He could be back up if Altherr struggles, or if we do decide to trade him at some point, which, you never know what could happen. Somebody in a rotation could get hurt, and I decided we want to go out and trade for a starter. Altherr could be a part of that package, and then Ordóñez would just come up, similar to like when McCutchen got traded last year. But yeah, that was pretty much all we did in free agency. Like I said, I didn't want to go out and break the bank this year. I feel like our team is already, as it was before we signed any of these guys, very good, and we could definitely make another deep playoff run. So I definitely feel like adding Joey Gallo, Ryan Presley, and Manny Margot makes it so we're even more primed for another deep playoff run this year. And then also, Joey Gallo will help us continue throughout the rest of his contract as well, when we are going to be retooling to have a bit of a different roster for the 2024 season and beyond. But of course, we have the 2023 season to get through first. So now taking a look at who some of the AI teams signed throughout the league, and there were quite a lot of them because there were quite a lot of good players in free agency this year. Starting off with the Yankees did, we know that they lost a bunch of players, and they ended up signing two pretty great pitchers in Jameson Taillon. They signed him to a 9-year deal, so Taillon's going to be pitching for the Yankees for a long time, and also Lance McCullers Jr. is going to the Yankees on a 5-year deal, while three former Yankees are going other places. Aaron Judge is now going to be on the Chicago Cubs for 7 years. That just makes my blood boil a bit there. And Gary Sanchez is going to the Minnesota Twins, yuck, for 4 years, as well as Chad Green going to the Minnesota Twins. The Twins are becoming the Yankees, essentially, and Gary Sanchez, definitely a big get for them, so is Chad Green. The Red Sox made a couple signings as well. Jose Berrios from the Twins, the 99 overall starter, is now going to be on Boston for the next 7 years. Marcelo Zuna was picked up on a 1-year deal by the Red Sox. They did end up bringing back Benintendi as well, so Benintendi did not go to a different team. He is back with the Red Sox. And then the Mets continue to be big spenders in free agency. They've picked up Mookie Betts in this franchise, and they still haven't made the playoffs since they've acquired Mookie Betts. So they went out and spent even more money this offseason. Jose Ramirez, who has put up consistent 900-plus OPSs for the Indians, he has been a huge reason why that team has been so OP in this franchise. He's going to be on the Mets now for the next 7 years, while Mitch Haniger, on a 2-year deal to the Mets, and Byron Buxton, which a 5-year deal. Buxton is a bit questionable for me because, yes, he is incredible defensively, but the Mets have had, they've held on to him throughout the duration of this franchise. They've had Keon Broxton, who is basically Byron Buxton, not just because their names are quite similar, but because they're basically the same player in this game. Broxton, great defensively, no bat. Buxton, great defensively, no bat. And they're paying significantly more money to Buxton than they would be to Broxton. And just having those two names cycle through my brain right now has just turned my brain to absolute mashed potatoes. The Houston Astros went out and picked up two guys as well, Yasiel Puig on a 2-year deal, as well as Carlos Martinez, the former Cardinal, now a member of the Astros for the next 5 seasons. The Cincinnati Reds went out and picked up two division foes who are now going to be playing for their team, two former Pirates in Josh Bell for 4 years and Joe Musgrove for 3 years, while the Pirates went out and picked up Mike Clevinger from the Indians for the next 3 seasons. Edwin Diaz is also picked up by Cleveland for 5 years. Devin Travis, the guy we traded for at the deadline, is going to be spending time in Cleveland from now on, while the world champion Los Angeles Angels picked up Chad Pinder for the next 3 seasons. And then Chad Pinder's former team, the Oakland A's, picked up Brandon Nimmo from the Mets for 3 seasons, and Jeurys Familia for the next 2 seasons. He is back in Oakland, where he spent the second half of the 2018 season in real life. And then the Dodgers, of course, upgraded. It wouldn't be an offseason with the Dodgers making a big signing, as they picked up Wilson Contreras on a 6-year deal. Their catcher will no longer be Keibert Ruiz. It will now be Wilson Contreras. Kevin Kiermaier was picked up by the Nationals on a 3-year contract, and then Carlos Cookie Carrasco was picked up by the Braves on a 1-year deal. Also, Albert Almora Jr. was picked up by the Mariners, and since they picked up a center fielder, I guess they decided they couldn't have two center fielders and just play one of them in left or center, so Malik Smith was traded to the Nationals for Trey Turner and Chris Owings, because Malik Smith has become an absolute stud in this, and I believe Trey Turner is on the last year of his deal. But I guess the Nationals decided they could have two center fielders because they just traded for Malik Smith, and they also just signed Kevin Kiermaier. So the Nationals now have Malik Smith and Kevin Kiermaier, while Trey Turner is now on the Seattle Mariners. Also, the Boston Red Sox have traded Roberto Ozuna to the Atlanta Braves, straight up for starting pitcher Kevin Gausman. So the Red Sox, they do have a pretty solid rotation. Obviously, they still have Chris Sale. They picked up Jose Berrios. Zach Wheeler has been incredible for them. And then Kevin Gausman is a mid-80s overall as well. And if you're wondering, David Price is no longer a member of their rotation. He has been bad in this franchise, and they actually DFA'd him, I believe. It was either DFA'd or his contract was up, and he's in free agency just sitting there. And then the Kansas City Royals picked up a reliever in Michael Givens from the Baltimore Orioles in return for 2 prospects, Chris Bubik, a starting pitcher, and outfielder Jeffrey Staples. And we actually made some extensions before the season started. The first one being Gilberto Fuentes was re-signed for the next 3 seasons. He has actually slimmed down. He's lost a few pounds over the offseason. He is committed to improving defensively and hopefully playing third base at some point in his career for us. And then Joey Bart, who was signed to a 4-year extension. He is one of the best offensive catchers in the league, ratings-wise and probably stats-wise as well, and he's also not too shabby defensively, so Joey Bart, our long-term catcher now. Elliot Ramos re-signed to 3 years. Jake Groom re-signed to 3 years. He's going to be a big, big part of our rotation once Skaggs and Gray leave probably next season, because I doubt either of them are back. And then TJ Trejo was re-signed to 4 years. He's going to have a pretty big part in the bullpen once Maranta, Iglesias, and Presley are probably gone next year. And Maranta, like I mentioned, he's probably going to be gone next year. He wants $10 million per. Him, Iglesias, Presley, Skaggs, Robbie Ray, Aaron Altair, I believe I might be missing a name or two, are all set to be free agents next season. I might re-sign one of those guys, but I'm not going to be able to afford to give all those guys $10 plus million because that's probably all what they're going to want, except for Altair, who doesn't really have a spot on my team after this season. So this will probably be a legit shot at the World Series for the 2023 season, and then for 2024, like I keep saying, we're probably going to have to retool a bit. I would predict we're still going to be a pretty good ball club, just not like possible 100 plus wins. And then while I've been talking about this, you've been seeing the opening day roster, the opening day 25-man roster scroll by. These are the guys who made the team. And if we take a closer look at what our rotation everything looks like, our rotation 1-2-5 is Derek Rodriguez, Robbie Ray, Tyler Skaggs, Dylan Bundy, who is back from his torn labrum, and then Jay Groom in the fifth spot. While in the bullpen, Josh James is actually going to be getting the long reliever spot to start the year. If he sucks like he usually ends up doing, he'll have to clear waivers again and be sent down to AAA or get picked up by a different team. While Braylon Marquez and Sean Anderson are starting the year in AAA, both of them could do that long reliever job easily. Marquez is probably my number one option to replace James to get another lefty in there, and also because I want Marquez to be getting plenty of time. But I figured I would at least give Josh James a shot at trying to prove he can finally do something for us in the bullpen, because ratings-wise, he's still very good. He just hasn't ever been able to actually put together a good season for us. While the rest of the bullpen is pretty much the same from last year, with Ryan Presley added on as well. And then if we take a look at the lineups against right-handed pitching, it's center field Manny Margot, left field Jock Peterson, shortstop Javi Baez, third base Joey Gallo, first base Gilberto Fuentes, catcher Joey Bart, right field Ramos, and then second base Peter Mooney, rounded up at the pitcher spot, of course, in the nine hole. And then the lineup against lefties is center field Manuel Margot, first base Seth Mejias-Breen. He has incredible plate discipline and also great contact and power versus left-handed pitching, so I figured put him in the two spot. He's going to get on base a shit ton. And then the shortstop is Javi Baez, third base Gallo, left field Stuart Fairchild, catcher is Joey Bart, right field Ramos, and second base is Mooney. And then as you can see, our opening day game for 2023, season 5 of this franchise, is going to be against the Arizona Diamondbacks, who had a very, very bad record last season, looking to improve upon that this year. There will also be two other games in the opening day episode. As always, there will be three games to start the season shown in that episode. I do not know what games those will be because I still haven't played them, so I can't tell you what games they'll be. But with that being said, that is going to wrap things up here for this edition of the San Francisco Giants franchise. I've been your host, Jerseyborn, and I am saying, DJ LeMahieu is here to rip out hearts.